So good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming to the second artist talk in the for contemporary art, Korean art talk. I'm very pleased to introduce artist Yoahn Han for an artist talk. Yoahn Han was born and raised in Korea and came to the United States for further art education. Yoahn received a BFA from the School of the Art Institute of Chicago and an MFA from Massachusetts College of Art and Design. His solo exhibitions were held in Boston, New York, New Jersey, and Seoul, and he has taught in numerous institutions, including Harvard University Mass Art and the Museum of Fine Art in Boston, and now teaches at the Rhode Island School of Design. As you may know, he was named as an Artist of the Year by the Korean Cultural Society of Boston in 2019. So today, Yoahn is wearing this beautiful Korean traditional dress called hanbok. But before we meet him, I would like to show you 3-minute video clips. So we will meet him through online first, screen first.
My name is Yoahn Han, and my profession is painter. At the same time, I'm art instructor in Mass Art and MFA Museum in Boston. And I've been doing painting perhaps about a little over 10 years. I was always wanted to be a painter, even when I was very, very young, about elementary school time, even though I did not really know what that meant to be a painter. But I always remember that I said that all the time, everywhere I go. I do have a very common theme, which comes along the last probably 5 to 10 years of time. But I'm basically talking about suppression and desire, and also the relationship in between birth and death. I do use a lot of metaphoric gestures and rather hide and seek. So I do use floral references together with natural phenomena such as fungus or other life organisms, because the way I see things would be very fresh and new for the people who have never seen my work before. As you see, my work is large, and also there are many meticulous process which almost act as if contemplating or kind of humming experience. I truly believe that each one of the individual, they have their own visual eyes, they have their own sense of imaginative world. However, when we grow up, we have our own work to do, and then every artistic aesthetics we have had has been just trapped inside of us. So I do believe that everybody has their own aesthetics. They just don't have visual or cognitive words developed that way necessarily yet. So I hope that art can make them to stay in art a little bit longer. I think to make art and showing it to the other people, the audiences, it doesn't grow their imagination, but rather it awakens the imagination they already had. I have a simple goal. Well, it's not simple, it's actually a great goal. I would like to be able to make it until whatever time available in my life. Because one point of my life, I realized that I don't want to be a cave painter. And somehow, some reason, I would like to get them to be shown to other people. And gallery has been the good, really nice platform to show it. Because I'm a maker. I keep making things. And I make, sometimes I have to let go, but I have to make another ones. So I feel that when I'm making artwork, it may feel very important. However, I have this belief that it may become a lot bigger than what it is now.
Great. So let's meet our artist, Yoahn. Hi, Yoahn.
Hello, everyone. Good evening, and thank you so much, Professor Kim, and also Korean Culture Society. And without the help of society and a consulate, I cannot make this talk going. It's very honorable for me to have a talk in front of those people in the association and further audiences. So I would like to start to talk about my journey in a chronological fashion. So I will do the share screen for PowerPoint to start. Is my voice going okay?
Yes, sounds fine.
Just a second. I'll just need to go all the way back. Okay. So I named it Fantasy, Romance, and Transcendence. It's because that was one of the classes actually I took from Chicago. In performance class, and the title of the class just summarized all the trial and errors and challenges I've been going through and I will go through. That's why I named it after. And this particular painting you're looking at right now is one of the most recent ones that I showed in the recent show. And I'll start to talk about my time in Korea first. I was born in Seoul, and I grew up in a small city called Chuncheon. And also I've been grown up as a household of Roman Catholic Church. And as you see from the left-hand side, I also served as an altar boy for 3 years in my life. And then growing up, I had a huge curiosity. Whenever I climbed the mountain or going to the rural hill areas, I saw many different types of shrines. In Korea, we call it shindang. And also in the middle of mountains, you may be able to see a holy tree decorated with cloths with beautifully decorated colors. It's called sonangdang. It's coming from the Korean tradition totemism. And whenever I'm curious about those ornamented shrines and ritual places, I was often discouraged to go near there. It's not going to be giving you a good spiritual quality. And those idea actually gave me more and more curiosity. What are they, and then what are they there? They must have something interesting, curious, or magical. And then, interestingly enough, not long after, I was given this 40 different Korean folklore storybooks series coming from Eungjin Publishing Company in 1989. And I was just curious and crazy about reading the whole stories, including the mythology of Bear Lady and also how we can see the eclipse, lunar and solar eclipse story in very interesting ways. But over the whole thing, one story that caught my eyes the most was about the Princess Bari. And Princess Bari is believed as if the first shaman in Korea, and it has its beautiful story behind it. And I still own the book, the one I took in the right-hand side picture. That's actually my own picture image. I took it. And the image you see from the left-hand side, it's practicing shaman who wears a costume of Princess Bari to honor her before and during they are doing the rituals. And as I mentioned, I was not a city boy. I grew up in a rural area. Chuncheon is a smaller city. It has about 300,000 people. In American point of view, it may be look as if a large big city, but in Korea, we were in this very mountainous and landscapey province called Gangwon. And growing up, it was very beautiful to see all those stratas and rocks everywhere I turned to. And this is actually a mountain called Samaksan. And even if it was beautiful, I was always hating to climbing the mountain. I didn't understand why my parents forced me to go there. And my dad started to tell me all different crazy stories. When you just climb this much, and when you see this little hole there, that's where the dragons live, and then you'll be able to see someday. So don't complain, we'll be okay. And all the rocks and trees, I did not really care that much for growing up, but if I look back in retrospect, those rocking formations and the colors are some kind of vivid memories that's hovering around my childhood memory all the time. And then I wanted to be an artist, and at the time I didn't know much, and we had to go through the prep test system. So I had to go through 2 years of training, which was very painful training. I wanted to be learning something more creative or things that can be fun. But the way I had to learn was more as if a rigid way of technical learning. And I was a little bit discouraged after I figured out I wasn't get accepted to the schools I applied. After I tried hard for 2 years in a row, and that was the time I was thinking, should I really carry on going for art, or it's just some of the little dream that I have to forget about? But then I had the determination, I wanted to continue finding a way to learn, and my family didn't give me an option to study abroad in the beginning stage, and I had to fight against them. I want to learn in a different circumstances with different cultural people. And in Korea, we have that expression that no parents will bid against the kid. And in the end, my parents told me that, okay, as long as you continue going for your passion, you can go abroad and study. Just you have to promise one thing for us. No matter how much brutal failure you're going to have because of your choice of doing art, especially fine art as your major, we are not the one to blame. And I said, I'll promise. You're not going to be hearing any of that from me. So that's some kind of my childhood story, if I just briefly go with that.
Well, thank you for sharing your very interesting story in Korea, also showing some mountainscapes of Korea for us who are not very familiar with Korean mountains and etc. So you came to the States in your early 20s. So what was it like? Did you have any challenges, like in terms of like language barriers, or did you see a lot of opportunities to pursue your artist dream? So can you tell us a little bit about like the beginning of your life in America?
I think I have to answer both, because of course I had nobody to speak with English before I came here. And after I came here, everything was new and language barrier was brutally challenging. But I was more excited to see new people, new culture, and new environment. So I was kind of crazy. I started to talk to everyone in the street. When I started to live in Bay Area, California, I even started to talk to this three-year-old kid who's playing with her friends. Or also I had this aunt I was living with. She was giving me a really hard training. I still have a trauma to go to Subway because she specifically trained me to order certain types of sandwich. And I had to know all the name of the bread and what kind of vegetables I have to order from, all those things. But on top of everything, all this museum experiences and talking to different culture people, everything was very revolutionary for my very limited access before. And a funny story, when I first got into the SF airport in 2006, it was totally different from my imagination. I thought because of I was the kid that's growing up with Hollywood movies, I thought I'm just going to see white American people or someone who doesn't look like me, but there are a lot more Asians and Latinos, intercultural peoples were around. Those were very interesting and unexpected phenomenon when I first got here. Yes. Is that answering your question?
Yes, you did. Thank you. And so how did you start your art educations? Like, are there any like teachers or influential people that gave you some, driving force to go? Or how was American art education different from that of Korea?
As I mentioned, my starting was not the rosy. I hit the rock bottom first, and then I thought that coming to United States is my last chance to grab into anything I can. And thankfully, I was able to study from my aunt first, because I used to live together with my aunt who studied sculpture in Ewha Women's University in Korea and also San Francisco Art Institute. And I was living with her and also learned from her. And she's right here, Kaylee, it's written there. And then after I spent 2 years in community college called Cheval College, fun fact, the actor from Forrest Gump also went to my college. And then I moved to Chicago. That was very, very eye-opening experiences. I still never forget my first day of class. Carl Worsham, the professor who's appearing in the left-hand side upper part of the screen, his class was my very first class. And after the rosters, and he said, okay, everyone, let's start something. And about 20, 30 minutes, I wasn't able to do anything. And then I just looked around everybody else's, and some kid was pouring coffees on the paper, or another student was doing some collage related work, and I was doing nothing. And he came to me and say, Yoahn, do you have anything you want to work with, or what kind of contents are you interested in? And I just started to realize that I've never given that permission before. I didn't even know that if I have things to express, if it's okay for me to search for something. And the first year was very bittersweet. I've had a lot of exciting trials at the same time. I didn't really know how to figure out my contents. And I realized that working with American students, that also gave me a synergy effect. So I had the skillful technical skills that I learned from Korea, but I didn't have the imagination or ideas that much. But a lot of American students I was working with, my peers, some of them had incredible thinking and the imaginations. Some of them just didn't have a hand for it. So we were team working together, and all the critics were working really well. And I was very lucky enough to meet a bunch of different incredible faculties, including Michiko Itatani, the Japanese faculty, and Judith Geichman. Michiko told me something that made me very angry in the beginning, and I'm very thankful now. She told me in one critique says, Yoahn, your painting, this particular painting is beyond your understanding level. I took it very badly. I was thinking, so you're thinking that I don't understand what I'm doing. And actually she was true. I just realized that what I make doesn't mean that I know what I did. It took me years of time to understand what I was doing sometimes. And then Judith was also the professor who actually gave me a clue of the synthetic paper called Yupo that I ended up falling in love to and still using in my major part of the surface treatment. And then also I was so naive. I never knew anything about working opportunity in the school. I was only thinking about, okay, I'm in great art school in Chicago and I just have to work. But I had a wonderful roommate and still really good friend, Ilwan. He was looking for something called internship. And I just asked, what is internship? What are you doing? And then it was an opportunity for work, and you can actually also work for your teaching, or also for a student, a teacher's assistantship, anything you can do. Funny enough, he just came from Korea, so he was not qualified to do internship, but then I spent 2 years already, so I was able to do it. So very first time, I was starting to work at the Boys and Girls Club as an art teacher, something I never expected, but I started to open the art room for them. I realized that the room has been closed for several years and the kids never had a chance to do any art activities. And instead of me teaching them, I just played with them a lot of times. And also in the end of my year in Chicago, I was fortunate enough to work in the FTCNS, the preschool 3 to 5 year olds, as an artist residency there. So about 8 months, I was playing with them, doing action paintings, going kids' places. And I achieved my childhood dream. I always wanted to take the yellow school bus. For the first time, I was able to do it. So that's my Bay Area, California, and Chicago experiences. Yes.
Wonderful. Wow. I'm so glad you met like these very three important mentors and teachers and artists. And I just have a quick question. You said about like technique called the Yupo. For yes. Those of us who are not familiar with artistic techniques, can you like explain a little bit more about Yupo techniques?
Absolutely. Yupo is actually, I don't know if it's correct for me to call it as a paper because it is 100% polypropylene. So I should call it as a plastic in a way. And I was doing some abstract expressionistic try back in the time of Judith Greitchman's class. And then she told me, Yoahn, you should maybe try out something called Yubo. You'll be able to find in Bleak or other art supplies. And I went there, actually, it was called Yupo. And I was able to try out. And the reason why I fell in love to it is because when you make a water pond types of situation happening on the surface, and the water doesn't go out like umbrella, it stays there. And you can work within the water with using water-based media. Even you can use oil-based media as well. But what's incredible thing about that surface is it takes 10 to 20 hours to dry, but it records the time of dry. So it slowly gives reticulation of mark, almost act as if the way you see from cut tree ring types of formulation. And when I saw that, witnessed it for the first time, I thought that will give me something greater than what I just see in the future. And that's when I start to fall in love to it. And I'll just have a side explanation of this particular image right now. So in the end of the time I was teaching in Boys and Girls Club, I was doing a decorative comedy activities with the kids. So it's a simple painting in one side and you just fold it and open it up. You can make a butterfly or almost blood Rochester test types of mark you can make. And most of the kids just did not take their work home. I always beg to them, please go show your parents and everything. So in the end, I took it in my studio and I put it in my wall and I started to analyze what they were doing. And that was exactly the time of my graduation almost. So I had to come up with my thesis. And this piece, Tortured Beauty in Asymmetry, is actually 1/3 of the time I owe to my children, students, and they gave me idea for doing that. And those two parts are not exactly symmetrical, but I was able to get the generic form from the kids. All the content material, I will be able to explain a bit later. So that's my time in the first two chapters of America.
Okay, well, thank you. And I was also really fascinated by your artistic inspirations. And early on, like you kind of mentioned about shamanisms and floral motifs. One of your theme was the floral decorated bier or the flower, you know, the palanquins. So tell us more about this artistic inspirations and motifs and subjects.
I see. So I moved to Boston for achieving my degree program for master's, and I finished my grad school by 2014. And at that point, I was just happened to be able to see that huge retrospective exhibition from Hokusai. I know that everybody knows that gigantic wave painting of his. So I didn't include that image. I included another image of his work there. And it was all about his work at the time. Simultaneously, every year I was able to visit Korea and then look at all these museums. And fun phenomena has been happening at the time, because before I left Seoul, I didn't really look at many traditional Korean art, but I just had this guts to tell me to look at it, go to the National Museum, and also even in my little small city, Chuncheon had beautiful museum, had the Korean traditional Minhwa and other types of paintings. And among them, I also was finding the Shin Saimdang's work, the famous watermelon and the bug painting. And the two different types of experience were colliding each other. And I had the thought, how can I make those, for example, hook size woodblock printing types of clean cut edged surface, same as the Minhwa's part two, without even using their own technique? Because I thought that some of the mark makings they have, it's way ahead of their time. Some of the clean cut, almost digital like gestures looked as if post contemporary paintings almost. So I just, as I mentioned, I was using the Yupo at that time still. I collide them together, didn't even meticulously cut. I just made a circle and triangle and put them together and just watching them for days and days and try to see what they are doing. And that's when I started to having my cutting professions. And before that, I want to just talk a little bit about my contents material. So that work I was talking about, it's tortured beauty and asymmetry. And I'm going to talk this in relation to this image I'm going to show you. I'm assimilating myself to dormant volcano a lot of times, because I was born with very rare physical condition called cerebral palsy. It's also called blood vascular malformation. So a few times a year, my right side of body gets paralyzed, and it has its own aura comes first, and then it just invades my entire body. So the disconnection between mind and body started to really weigh in my entire life. Because normally when you command something and your body has to follow, but it just didn't work that way. And that became my first lacking experience. Like, why am I not able to connect my mind and body the way I want? And that's when I started to think about the concept of death, not necessarily in the negative part. I was just thinking that kind of phenomenon act as if dying process. And I just started to get really upset with living and dying and what's going to be the place in between. And that's when I started to think about the palanquin and all the other things that you asked. So I just want to go to some places, and then I'll go back to the other slide. So I did a lot of traditional researches and found out two different types of boxes that really interested me. Actually, before I even found the traditional Korean box, the first box I was thinking about was the box from the Little Prince, Centenary book, that the box which supposed to have a lamb inside, but there's nothing in it. There's just three holes. And you can only see the anticipation of it. And also when you think about the Greek Roman mythology, the Pandora's box act very interesting way too. And I obsessively try to find the Korean box. And Sangyo is the floral bier casket in Korea. And that's been developed with many different doubtful associations. The Confucianism, Taoism, and Buddhism all conjointed together in the middle of the process of making. So when the village's important person dies, doesn't have to be a high rank person, the regular people dies, they put this dead body in the most beautifully, vividly, colorfully decorated box, which is called Sangyo. And Sangyo is normally decorated with lotus flowers and Korean phoenix and all different colors. And then everybody else is in the village, bring this Sangyo to that place of the person's barrier. And then they also chant and make songs. Normally 15 to 20 people bring that box to that place. And what fascinated me was the irony between decorated outside and the dead body inside. And I just was really curious about the journey. So this person in this world we are aware of just disappeared dead, but then what's the other door which we don't know about can be opening, the state between one to the other. And alongside the same idea, I was fascinated by the Korean palanquin too. The palanquin is very commonly used Western and Eastern culture, both in European culture and also Asian culture too. But I was specifically assimilating that life of a woman who got married and their destiny is changing back in the time in Joseon Dynasty in Korea. I'm not talking about current modern Korea. Back in that time, women's life changes when they get married. They get into the palanquin, and then when they get off from the palanquin, you become the husband's family. You're no longer your own family. I just thought about that transition is somewhat related to each other. So since you asked me about that flora buyer, flora palanquin, that was my answer and my interest. And then I would like to talk more further about shamanism after I briefly explain the technique that I'm using. So when I'm working, as I mentioned, I'm using the paper surface called Yupo. And then what it does, I explained already earlier. And when you see the right-hand side of the paper right now in the screen, that's what the watermark it makes. So all these little marks are not necessarily made by me. It's made by the water and its height that makes the beautiful mark. And the fun fact is that when it dries out completely, since it's very synthetic plasticky surface, it still looks as if it's wet, although it dries out. And then I flip it without knowing which color is where. And that's when I started to cut specific motif and decorative shapes of the spire, palanquin, and other floral fauna shapes. That's the techniques I use. And I would like to talk a little more about my obsession of Korean shamanism in relationship to my early childhood obsession as well. So Korean shamanism it's also called Muism because we call the shaman as a Mudang, and also male shaman is Paksu. And then the Mudang Mu is where the Muism is coming from. And also Mudang is very traditional prototype of Korean priest. It's that person in the village and the town that does all these rituals. And also they are artists too. They are dancers, they are painters, they are artists, they're healers. They used to be everything back in the time. Nowadays, we have all these different professional people, but they also have a different types. One type is the Mudang type. Mudang is the one who actually get the call. So they were chosen by the deities and then they suffer. And then the suffering part is called Shinbyeong. And when you have the Shinbyeong, they have a crazy phenomenon happening. Some psychological professionals may call it as a schizophrenic. They start to hear things, they cannot sleep, and all different phenomena happening. So if they cannot bear that pain, that's when they get the ritual from another shaman, and that's when they become shaman. And that's what I said, Mudang type as a Gangshinmu. And there's another type called Dangor type, which is also called Sesubmu. So Mudang type is more prominent in northern part of Korea. And Gangshinmu is the other way of calling it. And Sesubmu is more like a hereditary tradition. So those village people who had the shaman before, and then they learn all these dances and rituals, and it's hereditary coming along with the different generations. And that's just different things about shamanism I've learned. And also Mugu is the object that has been used in the shamanism, including the hat of general, and also there are very beautifully ornated bells that brings the spirit or ghost. And they also have this chopper where the shamans actually stand up with bare feet when they do the ritual sometimes. And they also have different types of sword and five different colored flag they have, including white, blue, yellow, green, and red. And this is actually painting of Shin Yunbo, the painter, which was around, he was around 1758 to 1814, and he portrayed the actual ceremony of shamanism ritual. And it doesn't involve only the shaman, but also, as you see, all this, I would say Korean orchestra at the time, and all the other people are looking at it. And this woman is one of the major reasons why I was able to be super interested in shamanism. Her name is Kim Gung-hwa. She died in her age of 88. She was born in the 30s in Haeju, North Korea, and then had to come to South after the Korean War. And she became a big shaman even from her early age of 17. And then she practiced until she was dead. And I was able to see her only because movie director Park Chang-kyung, who's a younger brother of Park Chan-wook, everybody knows the movie Old Boy. And his brother made this faction movie. So part of documentary, part of fiction. And that film just told me so much about that ritualistic phenomena that involves a lot of colors and a lot of different types of dances. And I thought that, as I mentioned earlier, I took this performance classes, and I felt so bad that I didn't even know about the dancing rituals that has already happening in Korea for really, really long time. That part was really fascinated me. And as I mentioned, my first initiation of interest came from the Princess Bari story. So if I just summarize the story very quickly, there was a kingdom where the king was about to marry, and he really wanted to have a son. But there was an oracle that he had to wait a year after so that he can have a son. And he couldn't wait. He married and have 6 daughters. And then they were waiting for the 7th one, believing, oh, it must be a boy. But again, a princess came to birth. And the king Ogu was very angry and put her in the ornated box and threw her to the river. But it was not just disappeared. All the fishes and other natural spirits were protecting the box. And this 2 old couple found the box and raised the girl. And then later on, she was able to know her royal identity. And she went back to the parents. And the king and queen had a really terminal disease. And the oracle came to them again. Only she can save you. And then only thing that can save them is to find that magic water. And nobody were able to come back from wherever they had to go. And she volunteered to go save her parents. So she had to go through 12 different hell, different types of hell with different types of spirits. And she was able to reach the place where she was able to get the water. But then the gatekeeper also told her, you have to do 3 years of water work, 3 years of fire work, and 3 years you have to be married, have 3 kids. And she had to do all those missions and finally get the water and came back. It was too late. The parents were dead. And she still splattered the water to the grave and was able to save the parents. And the parents told her, okay, body, I think you should rule the country. We were so brutal and heartless. And she said, that's a wonderful offer. However, I've seen so many people in between state, between this world and the world of the dead. So I rather want to be the mediator. So she was believed to be the first shaman of Korea. And even now, a lot of shamans, when they do the rituals, either initiation or in the middle of that, they put the part of her story. And what interests me personally in my work was because I was thinking a lot about being abandoned in different ways. And that story and the whole shamanistic rituals told me being abandoned, it can be just the next door open for the hopeless. The anticipation can open a new hopeless. That's what happened. So that's my understanding of shaman. And my knowledge of shaman is not a knowledge as an insider. I approached it as if an anthropological viewpoint in the beginning. So I cannot dare to say I know much about shamanism. I just got deeply inspired from whatever I've been watching so far. And one more thing I want to talk about, that floral casket I was mentioning earlier. And they have something called goktu. Goktu is the ornated little, I don't want to say the word, but I have to say the word doll. In Korea, it has a little different meaning than doll. It's more like an entity. But they are decorated inside the sangyeo, the box I was mentioning earlier. And the goktu also means it's the limit of one realm of reality to the other. So they are the protective places, almost like in the gatekeeping position of entities. So that's some other ornamentation that is needed to the floral casket. And then I want to talk about another types of motif I use in my work a lot. So as I mentioned, death became a very prominent topic for me, not as a negation, but as the flip side of life and death. And white chrysanthemum is very commonly used in South Korea in the funeral. It's a flower of the death. And also lotus it's beautiful when it blooms, but it started with very dirty water. And a lot of different types of religions had some doubt about lotus, especially the Buddhist and some other Korean tradition or Taoistic tradition as well. And then excluding the traditional facade, I was going deeper and deeper in the relationship between death and living and death and sex. And Titan Arum, it's a largest flower on earth, coming from Sumatra Island in Indonesia. And the fun part is that it looks phallic, at the same time it smells a dead body. And that double part of the flower, just I couldn't get over it. And I just kept on looking for more and more things. And cordyceps is another crazy materials that I use as a symbolic signature in my work a lot of times. In Korea, we call it dongchung hacho. Actually, it has a beautiful meaning. When you put this Chinese character in literal senses, it means in the winter, it is a bug. In the spring, it's a plant. So it's a plant, but moving. So what happens is that it's actually a fungus that put their pollen inside the living insect and bloom in there, manipulating the insect's brain synapses and the taste, also modifying it. And the next image is the two praying mantis. So praying mantis have this sexual cannibalism happening. So when they are copulating, or after they copulated, the female oftentimes eats the male. And that phenomenon is something that I can never understand and never comprehend, but happens in the natural phenomena. And that also became my contest material. So now I would like to just briefly go over the works in chronological matters. So those are the very first reiteration of me cutting papers and then doing a collage work. And this image in the right-hand side is actually the image of my background right now. And that's the Yupo paper. I cut it with using chrysanthemum and pagoda shapes. And then I was just doing more as if the traditional Korean roll paper painting as my homage. And everything started from there. And it got transformed. It got through metamorphosis afterwards. That's also very early reiteration of 2015. You may be able to see by now a lot of repetition of symbolic gestures keep coming in and out. So it's called the transcendence. And the entrance is another work. I started to use more prominent colors. And you can still see the gestures of floral and architectural spaces keep coming in. And those are another chronological works. They're oblivion, blooming. The blooming is very interesting process for me. It was the time that I thought, okay, one painting at least, I don't want to use any color at all. I just want to cut the paper. And probably this is a different skill shifting chrysanthemum, about 30 different pieces. And I did not make any color reiteration. Everything was just cut papers in the very last image. And as I mentioned, I know it sounds crazy, but the praying mantis became my new lover at the time. And then that became another source materials. And this is called Atelier Desire. And even more recently, I'm still using those motifs, but the colors sometimes changing and the situation changes. Deep down under this, in this case, I wanted to make it almost as if like very under the sea situation, and then the black ink was reinforcing the darkness more. And I'm shifting to a different types of figurative gestures. It started from my 2019 solo exhibition and things are becoming slowly more figurative. And that work is called Life Within the Skin. I was thinking about human body inside is constructed by something other than human element, floral and fauna elements, which I mentioned earlier.
Well,
yeah.
Okay, well, thank you very much for very, very rich and very deep contents and motifs and inspiration. So I want to give you a small break, but what I would like you to what I would like to do now is like before Yoahn give more deep analysis of his work, why don't we watch like short video of his the most recent exhibition view. So let's
Should I unshare screen for now?
Yes, please.
Okay, all right.
Okay, do you see the... So this is the most recent exhibition, right? At Chase Young Gallery.
It just ended on May 1st.
Okay, well, so let's watch... Can't make you happier now. Sometimes all I think about is you. Late nights in the middle of June. He waves been faking me out. Can't make you happier now. Usually I put something on TV so we never think about you and me. But today I see our reflections clearly in Hollywood laying on the screen. You just need a better life than me. I mean, it's really fascinating, so exquisite, delicate. But what really outstanding to me is like colors, so vibrant colors. I'm sure, the viewers have lots of questions about techniques and style, but I would like to ask you about these vibrant colors. How do you choose the color palettes? And can you tell us a little bit more about like any aesthetic philosophy you have regarding colors?
Absolutely. So I was always fascinated by the time of in European and also Korean time of certain period. In European time of Rococo, that's the time period I was always fascinated in. And also in Korea, either Silla Dynasty or Goryeo Dynasty. There were reasons for it, because those were the moment of time where the male and female, regardless of the sex, they were having to put themselves in colorful format, not only inside, but also outside of the garments. That's the time the male, female, both were decorated in certain manners and certain fashions. And some of the colors coming from that always hovering around my mind, especially the baby blue color and salmon pink and some patina green colors. And in Korea, in Goryeo Dynasty, we have amazing pottery has been made with it using a lot of green celadon colors. It's in Korea, we call it as a bisek. And those are colors that I use a lot of times first. And also I use a lot of natural, gender neutral phenomena or gender opposite phenomena happening in the birds. So I included the image of peacock, male peacock right there, and also the one-armed bird in the right hand side. So that's a prototype of colors. And obviously, if you see the far left hand side upper part, the beautiful tanchang, which is the roof bottom of Korean buildings, I use those crazy colors that reappearing in all the shamanism part as well. And those are the colors I use. And when you ask me about the philosophy, I look at many different people. One of the person I look at a lot of times is a French philosopher, Bataille. Bataille has its own triangular trinity between human as a human, and human as a sanctified being, and human as an animal. So three different parts of human being existing. So human goes lowest low and highest high, and that's a universe of the human cycles. And that just gives me a lot of ideas. And he also talks about really, really big question between living and eros part versus dying as a Thanatos, the impersonated god of death. So that's kind of the philosophy I read a lot. Yeah.
Thank you. We don't have much time left. So I was wondering if you can kind of like select a few of your, you know, works that you can go, you know, explain it a little deeper and in details to us.
Okay. Normally I like most recent works, and that's in this case the same way. The Flower Boy, The Floating Torso, and that In Search of Floral Bodies, those three are the works that I have a deepest attachment for now. So I was a lot more trapped, no, I shouldn't say trapped, I was a lot more interested in each one of the symbolic system itself throughout the last 4 or 5 years. But now I am inclined to make a figurative gesture out from those motifs. I already mentioned briefly earlier, but for example, the Flower Boy is my idea of the landscape is awakening as if a figure. And all the pink part is still collective masses of chrysanthemum, still happening that way. And the floating torso is probably the most prominent body part appearing in my work recently. And I was thinking about in the water, you can only see certain part of the body. For example, when you're in the bath. Or I was also thinking about part of the Hamlet, the Ophelia situation, like a dying corpse in the river. So some part of the physical figures are known to us, some part are not. And I'm just gonna say one more thing about this particular work, In Search of Figure Floral Bodies. First of all, that's the largest single piece I've done, 64 by 80. And I was trying to find utopia in my own senses. The yellow sections are the shelters or outer space, and all the other universes are hovering around. At the same time, as I mentioned, the figure became dominant. And even the title came from the French novel In Search of Lost Time from Marcel Proust. So when you have a one little reiteration, one little biscuit can just go all the way over your old memories coming back. So I think that some of the little touches of gesture can just reopening whole new world for you. And I don't know where it's going after, but I'm still in my studio trying to rustle through.
Great. Yes. Thank you. Before I open the floor for Q&A, I just want to ask you, do you have any exhibition or workshop coming, you know, next year or?
Yes. Next year in February in Newton Arts Center, I am having a artist talk slash demonstration that is scheduled in the February. And in terms of the exhibition, I just finished the solo show and I don't have a major exhibition coming yet.
Okay.
It's time to work.
time to be productive. Well, thank you. And now I would like to, open the floor for Q&A. So please, I'm sure there are lots of questions about your work and philosophy and motifs. So please feel free to.
I have a question. Your, thank you so much for your wonderful presentation. It was very enlightening.
Thank you.
You have many layers in your work. So how do you, some of them, the Yupo cut is very intricate. So how do you finish your painting? What kind of finish do you use?
So I do two different types. One type I make, present my work in the paper itself and doing certain types of framing called shadow box, so that my paper and the glass has a little bit of space so people can actually see that collage sections. Or recently I'm more often starting off the whole work in the wood panel. And after I finished the work, I applied epoxy resin. So it's giving a glassy surface and illuminates the color of the pieces a lot more because the paper surface itself is synthetic, and that somehow gives more vibrant colors. And also it's a protective surface as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes, Lynn, go ahead. You are on mute. Can you unmute?
Yes, thank you so much. And what kind of paint are you using on your Yupo paper?
I use all different types of water soluble media, including watercolor, acrylic gouache, and also acrylic paint.
Okay.
And I just put them together sometimes like a mad alchemist.
Yeah. And then I see behind the stencils, I see, you know, sometimes the Yupo is covered with a solid color. So is that the same kind of paint?
That part, I sometimes use the acrylic gouache itself, like very thick, or I also use the French paint called flash. Flash paint, yes.
Okay. Yeah, I like it a lot.
Oh, thank you.
Hi, Yoahn. Thank you very much for the presentation. Really fascinating. I think just two questions. The material, Yupo, why does it take so long to dry? And then I noticed on some of the pieces, it was, it had the red pieces had bubbled up. So it was like,
Yes, I had so much other things to talk about. So I didn't, forgive me. The first question first. What was the first question again? I'm crazy now. So why it took so long? Okay, it's because it's a very synthetic surface. So in normal watercolor paper, the paper really suck it up to observe the water. Yeah. But the Yupo is, as I mentioned, it's a synthetic surface of plastic. So what happens is the water just evaporate and paint sit on the surface. Mm-hmm. It takes longer time to do it because the paint doesn't have anywhere to go in.
Sure.
So for example, when you clean the table, the cloth has to suck up the water, but Yupo cannot do that. It's more like a staining than painting in that sense. And that sculpture element you talked about, that's a paper pulp. Mm-hmm. So paper pulp in Korea, we also have the tradition of jeongijuk. And I don't use the Korean traditional way. I actually learned in my mixed media class in United States. And then I use water and different types of paper and glues, just mixing it with sticky and then apply color there. Yeah, that's all these sparkly little things you saw. Any other question?
Yes, I think we have time for one last question.
So I'm wondering, it must take a long time to finish one work. How long does it usually take to make one work?
Yes, it's very meditative process, and I don't work one at a time. I work 3 to 5 at a time. So I consistently drawing and cutting the papers. So about a few months, my studio is filled with all cutouts, jungle. So every 3 months, I think I make 3 to 5 works in different size. Yes.
Thank you. Lynn, do you have any last comments or?
I've been making stencils to use for monotypes. So, and usually it's floral, like ferns or lilies. So I make stencils of plants. I do, yes.
Great. Well, thank you. Well, thank you everyone for coming to the second of the 4 presentations in the Artist Talk series. So next Saturday, we have artist Seongmi Nan, who is presenting her folk art paintings. Okay, well, thank you, Yoahn Han, again for wonderful presentations. So you're welcome to hang around, hang out and talk. But I think official recording is stopped now.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you.